This is Party of Six, a brand new concept in business television. We have a group of four business leaders from the same industry getting together for a business lunch, along with two CNBC Africa journalists, and we let the cameras roll.
I prefer not to be called a magician, but an illusionist, because everything we do, and all four of us are in agreement on that, is an illusion.
Can you see brown? Whatever you do, don't take your eyes off the note. And I say the magic words, party of six. See, changes right there.
No.
To a 20 euro note.
Now the coins are gonna transfer from my hand and they're gonna land in your hand. You'll feel the coins arrive. All it takes is a little squeeze, a little shake.
So a radio station phoned me a few weeks ago to have a whole discussion about card counting. I do in my shows a technique where I actually memorize an entire shuffle pack of cards.
I put the telly on and there we saw David Blaine's street magic. When the student is ready, the master will appear. And that night, It was as if something inside me had shifted. I knew without a doubt that this was what I wanted to do.
Welcome to Party of Six. South African stand-up comedy received a major boost in December 2008 with the opening of Parker's Comedy and Jive at Monte Cassino in Four Ways. The venue, purpose-built to showcase the art of stand-up comedy, has featured the best in both local and international comedians. Today, Party of Six is filming in Parker's at Monte Cassino. Today, your hosts Nozipho Banjwa and Natasha Jacobs chat to a round table of magicians in this special hour-long episode of Party of Six. So stay tuned for the next hour to experience all the fun, laughter, and amazement in the wonderful world of magic.
Gentlemen, on behalf of CNBC Africa, I'd like to welcome you to Party of Six. Now, I know who you are, but I'd like to introduce you to our audience. From my right, I'd like you to introduce yourself and also just give us a bit of a background on what type of magic and what kind of magician you are.
I'm Mauro. My little tag is the man whose hands do feats. And not many people understand it, but I do, which is the important thing. And I got a box of tricks for Christmas when I was very small, about 8-9 years old. And the bug bit, and I developed. I've come from a bit of a broken home, and I worked myself and my younger brother and sister through school doing kids' shows. And my first years of varsity too, I worked through doing kids' shows and what we call table hopping, which is one branch of magic at a restaurant. You don't work for the tips, the management pays you to go around table to table and do your tricks. My first visit to South Africa was with a Peter Tureen show.
You're originally from the UK.
Yes. And going around South Africa, I saw this lovely big yellow thing in the sky called the sun. And I thought, this is beautiful. I'd never seen this in the south of England. At the moment, what I'm doing is I'm working with an organization called Reach for a Dream.
Yeah.
With kids that have life-threatening illnesses. It's emotionally challenging, and it's not like a regular show. You can't expect that reaction from the kids because they're feeling grotty. But a social worker who works for these kids said to me, because I did worry, am I fooling myself? Am I really making a difference? And she told us, she said, without knowing my doubts, she said, believe me, the effect of your visits last.
Right, my name is Andre, and I had a brief interest in magic when I was about 7 years old. My brother, who was 12 years older than me, showed me some magic. And it wasn't long after that, I think about 2 or 3 years later, went into a library, found a book on magic. But now you must keep in mind, 40 years ago, there was no social media, no internet. The only resource at your disposal was a library. But they only had one book. So consequently, I sort of lost interest in magic, developed other interests like electronics, because there was more books.
Yeah.
And eventually, I think it was around about 87, when I just got married. And just after I'd gotten married, found some more books on magic, so magic resurfaced.
Your viewers probably know me better as a soccer commentator across the African continent. But that was actually quite a diversion for me, because when I was at school, I was incredibly shy, really incredibly shy. I wouldn't even ask questions in front of the class or put my hand up and ask the teacher anything. And they actually said to me, Why don't you get into magic or some sort of performance arts to try and get over your shyness and get over your fears of talking in front of people? And then I got into mentalism, which is magic of the mind, which for me is extremely fascinating and fits in with what I do, because I run training courses for schools, for school kids, university students, showing them how to use their memory productively. And mentalism is a branch of magic which is basically magic of the mind. It uses magical methods, but it also uses a lot of true memory and mathematical ability and all these sort of things. And I thought this fits in nicely with my personality.
Well, my name is Mohammed. My performing name is Mo Magic. And I've been doing magic, I would say, for the least amount of time compared to my peers. But magic is really a passion for me. It started at university about 12 years ago. I was going through a period of self-reflection. I was looking at my life and my path. And I started going for personal development courses. There I learned a number of amazing, profound insights. One of which is, we could choose the quality of life we want for ourselves. It doesn't matter who you are, where you've come from, but it's about who you are now and what you want for yourself going forward. And I set an intention out to the universe, and I basically said, I would like to find my purpose, my calling. I put the telly on, and there we saw David Blaine Street Magic. Wow. And Mauro, the most fascinating thing was that 3 years prior, I had seen the same show, but when I looked at the show, yeah, it was, it must be a camera trick. Yeah. But there's a Zen proverb that says, when the student is ready, the master will appear. And that night, It was as if something inside me had shifted. I knew without a doubt that this was what I wanted to do.
It was that moment.
As a black person at the table, when I think about magic growing up, it was just like, okay, that's witchcraft. You know, it's evil, it's witchcraft, it's bad, it's negative. It's not, magic has no place in my culture. Yeah. Magic has no place in my tradition.
I love that you asked that question, and I'm sure everybody else does here, because we are magicians. Magicians perform the art of magic. We do not delve into the dark arts that people associate with religion, yeah, and superstition.
I have a different take on that. I prefer not to be called a magician, but an illusionist. Because everything we do, and all four of us are in agreement on that, is an illusion. The rainbow. I mean, how many people out there understand how a rainbow works? It's a trick of the light.
I would say magic is a theatrical art, fundamentally. And it's really just a combination of different elements. Elements such as science, psychology, drama, misdirection, specific principles, and in some cases, digital dexterity. You'll see Mo now. And but by misdirecting the senses, one can actually give the impression of something supernatural.
Yeah.
You know, think of John Edward. And but it's a creation of something, it's a creation of an impossibility. That's what you're trying to do. That's where the art comes in. It's that astonishment that you first felt when you saw the effect. Now, what is magic? Let me ask you this question. What is fear? Fear is seeing a snake and your body or your physical being and your mental being reacts in a specific way. What is comedy? Comedy is a comedian telling a few jokes, throwing out some words to you. And that interpretation of those words creates laughter. So what is magic? Magic is the creation of astonishment.
Mentalist, unlike a magician, there's an area of believability that you're trying to establish in the sense that mentalism does use magic methods, but it also uses, as I mentioned earlier, a lot of memory techniques. If you've got a good memory, it's a prerequisite, certainly for the act that I do. You need to be able to memorize all sorts of different things. So there is the believability element, there's the reading body language, psychological suggestion, all those sorts of things. And I find when people come and watch my shows, they're prepared to believe that it is possible. So they almost, other than the few skeptics that you have here and there.
How do you deal with those skeptics?
Oh, you call them up and you let them participate. And you, yeah, absolutely, and you show them things that cannot be trick methods. You show them legitimate things, and eventually, hopefully, you get them to believe that it is possible. Or alternatively, you don't. They go home and they say, it's just a trick, or whatever it is. But it's an amazing, almost juxtaposition of feelings and emotions, how people can come there being skeptical at the beginning and then can almost transform their beliefs.
Suspension of disbelief. This is what we're asking people. When you go to a movie, the movie can make you laugh, can make you cry, can make you sad. But you could sit back and think, I wonder where the director is sitting. We are entertainers. Yeah. using this as our medium.
As a vehicle.
And if you're going there to watch how something is done and your whole focus is, I wonder how he's doing that, what method is he using, you're losing out on all the magic that is actually happening because you're not allowing yourself to enjoy what's happening. You're being too analytical and you're using your left brain all the time.
How much of an act is in your act?
I try and keep myself who I am, you know. I'm not an actor. Although there has been a saying that says a magician is an actor playing a part of a magician. But in my case, I keep who I am in my magic. Because what is magic, as far as the art is concerned? If you really think about it, magic is more, or art is more than just brush strokes on a piece of canvas. Mm. It's about injecting a little bit of your own personality, your beliefs, your interests, putting all that into your art, which in our case is magic.
The media dubbed me the James Bond of magic because I love, yeah.
Mr. Suave.
Apparently so, yeah. Today I've opted for a bit more casual.
I can understand. But
oh, thank you, you're very kind.
Nice. He's been in it for 007 years.
Nice. So in terms of persona, I on stage, I'm the same person. And my selection of material is dependent on what interests me and what I find emotionally engaging with my audiences. Yes. And because I perform primarily at corporate events, we have a lot of different people from different cultures in the audience. Yeah. So I look at some sleight of hand, I look at some mentalism, and sometimes we chat about some mentalism ideas, we bounce ideas off each other. I look at, I haven't done any escapology on stage, but different genres of the art, I look at, because I find different people like different pieces of magic.
That's a very good point, Maya. It's similar to music, because you wouldn't play rock music at a funeral. So the music has to fit the environment, you know, and it's the same with magic. There are so many genres of magic, so much magic that fits your style, your personality, that it becomes a selection process. Do-do-do-da-da.
For a long time in an era where things were censored, music was censored, movies were censored, was magic censored? And Maori, you're perhaps the best person to talk about this and also bridging the cultural gap, because I did some research and I think most people would consider the top three South African magicians of the time is Martino, Daryl Cutler and Wolfgang Riebe. I mean, those are the most associated three white gentlemen. So how do we, number one, break the stereotype? Number two, was there a time when magic was censored and how has that changed in your experience? And then perhaps you who started late in the industry.
Yes, it was particularly given to white magicians like the three you've mentioned who were on television. And there was an Indian magician, Kardani, who took a whole show around South Africa, big stuff, what we could call grand illusion. The public considers sawing a woman in half and hopefully restoring her is an illusion. We among ourselves call it a grand illusion.
Now they call it plastic surgery, by the way.
And even the little things that we might be doing now are all illusions. That's why I say I prefer to call myself an illusionist. But interestingly, Andre works at casinos. I also work at casinos. And even though I don't gamble, and people say to me, Mauro, do you gamble because you're here? I said, no, I live in Johannesburg. This is a gamble enough. I get my tricks to work in their hands. And I said, wow, how did you do that? For example, may I show you something? Pack your cards. I'm going to ask you to touch the back of one of these cards. I suggest you don't touch the top one or the bottom one, because I probably know them. Just touch the back of any one. You happy with that one?
Yes.
You want to change your mind?
No.
I mean, what's the point of having a mind if you can't change? Show it around, but not to me and to the camera.
Close your eyes.
Okay. Was that a free choice?
Yes.
We haven't arranged anything before. And by the way, if anyone can prove that we've set up anything before the show, I'm willing to accept 5,000 rand from any charitable organization.
To accept it? Okay.
No.
All right.
Okay. Was that a free choice? You said yes.
Free choice.
Easier than I thought, because I know that card was a joker.
You're wrong.
No, it must have been the joker.
You're absolutely wrong.
You seem happy about that, Nosy. I'm being a little on edge here.
I'm not happy. I'm actually a little bit of anxiety because I think he's got another trick up his sleeve.
No, it's only my two arms. What is it? Have I blown it? You might as well show me. It is my card.
Ta-da!
How unhappy can I be? Out of a whole pack of jokers, you would take the 1 6 of hearts. Why didn't you tell me she's a magician? Really?
These days you can buy on the internet and you can buy all over the world from magic companies, DVDs. And you can learn various illusions and various card tricks and everything else. And what happens is you produce a conveyor belt of young magicians who come out there, they see how it's presented, a style that fits the particular performer, and they perform it exactly the same way with the same jokes and the same patter and the same everything else, and it doesn't work for them.
Do you have a bad day and how do you cope with that?
We're actors.
You act your way out of it.
And we have to. We do have bad days. And sometimes, this morning actually, when I was working on some of the things that we might get to today, it was so cold that I thought, I'm not going to do this. Do either of you play cards?
Not very well.
No. I've never even played Snap with the family, and I got conned into a game a couple of months back. I was walking down Pritchard Street, and a shifty bloke on the side said, come here. I said, what's up? He said, you look like a sporty kind of gent. Well, I could tell already he needed glasses. He said, you want to earn some easy money? I said, what do you mean easy money? He said, over here, I've got three cards. He said, one of them is a black card, got another black card, but the one you must keep an eye on is the red card. I said, how do you mean keep an eye on it? He said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix these cards around, and if you can tell me where the red card ends up, I'll double your money. I thought, that's fair, there's 10, I reckon the red card's on the bottom. He said, I'm sorry. I said, come on, I've got glasses, I need another chance. There's another 10. If it's not on the bottom, I reckon it must be on the top. He says, sorry, you lose again. I said, no, this is, well, now I'm going to win it all back. I said, there's another 10. If it's not on the bottom or the top, it must be in the middle. He said, so sorry. I said, hey, you're cheating me, you've got more than three cards there. He said, no, I've only got 1, 2, 3. He says, but I tell you what I'll do. He says, I like you. Not a lot, but I like you. He said, if you happen to have, if you want to play it again, how about putting down another 60 rand and winning the lot back if you tell me where the other, where one of the black twos is? I thought, that doubles my chance. I'm in. There's another 10. I reckon one of the black twos is on the bottom. He said, I'm sorry. I said, no, now I can't lose. I said, there's another 10. There must be a black two on the top. He said, I'm sorry, you lose again. I said, this is crazy. There's another 10. There must be a black two in the middle. He said, so sorry. I gave up. I turned away and discussed. He said, come back here, Sonny. You can tell how old he was if he called me Sonny. He said, there's the red card. Oh, sorry. There's the red card. There's one of the black twos. How about playing doubles or quits? Put another 60 down, win the whole lot back just by telling where the other black two is. I thought to myself, Mauro, you were stupid to get involved in the first place, but I learned my lesson, never play cards again. At least I could break even. I said, thanks very much. There's another 60, the other black two's in your right hand. He said, uh-uh. I said, you must be joking. He says, no, I'm not the joker, you are.
Oh, wow.
So it's the way you present it that gets that emotional appeal from people. One of the things that I found has worked really well for me is to look at what people, I mean, obviously we learn what we do and we work long hours at it, but if an audience member, I sometimes think to myself, if I were a real magician, what would I be able to do? So I use that type of rationale to come up with material. For example, do you have a note on you? Great, because one of the things that earlier I mentioned, Nosy,
20 good enough?
20 will work. Money is one of those things that's that really...
Especially if you're a journalist.
Yeah, especially if you're a journalist.
It's scarce.
Okay, so let's think about this, and I'm going to try and get you both in the frame here, so we can get, you know, a good shot on that. I want you to watch very carefully, all right? Let's think about this.
Don't take my money.
Okay, I won't take your money. I was going to do something with it, but let's see. Remember, if I were a real magician. If I were a real magician, and if I could change this to any currency, what would impress you?
Euro.
Pound.
She said euro.
Although the pound's worth more, but
okay.
Let's go with
okay, euro. Okay, we have to be together.
Okay, are you together?
Yeah, we'll go with euro.
We'll go
okay,
with
great.
As long as not rand.
Okay, great. Watch carefully. No, he was not my misdirection, by the way. Here we go, all right? Okay, watch carefully. Keep your eye on the note. All I do is I fold your note. You gave me a 20, hey?
Yeah.
Watch. Keep your eye on it. Can you see that? Can you see brown? Whatever you do, don't take your eyes off the note. Watch this. All I do is I take it, I just squeeze and blow. And I say the magic words. Party of six.
No.
Wait, don't turn away. Don't turn away. You see, it changes right there.
No.
I'd rather keep this
to
one.
To a 20 euro
no.
note. Thank you very much.
No way.
Oh, okay, wait. It's for her. Would you do me a favor?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Would you do me a favor? Would you examine that? Make sure it is legit. Everybody can check it out as well.
This is a proper euro. It's yeah. All the great security
features.
Oh, it's yeah. So much better.
Can
than
we make
rad.
These? Can
yeah,
we,
yeah, yeah. If you ask nicely, can I show you something with this? 20, hey. So you could have said any currency. You said pound initially, but when you asked for clarification, you said you'd agree with the euro. Okay, euros is good, but watch this. I'm gonna do this for you right here. Would you do me a favor? Would you put your hand out for me? A little there. You might just scream. Euros is good, currency is good, but I believe gold is a little better.
Wow, that's a proper Kruger.
And that is a Kruger.
And the weight's
brand.
There.
And it's a weight, proper, make sure it is legit.
That
is,
yep. Okay, I wouldn't chew it like they usually do, but that's like a proper weight at Kruger.
Brian brought up an interesting
thing. We just increased it.
It's Mo actually, I don't know, it's Mo. No.
Can you read a psychopath?
Can I?
Read a psychopath.
Very interesting question. I've been asked that quite a bit. I'd say it's a lot more difficult than the average man
because
in the
streets. Because they do not show emotion, they don't emote, they don't identify with emotion. Is that part of
That's
mentalism?
Absolutely part of it. I do a lot of reading on body language. I read lots of different authors. Alan Pease is a very, very well-known body language author. For example, the court case that's going on at the moment.
Yeah.
People ask me about that all the time. What do I think about Oscar Pistorius? Or what did I think about this person or that person or Bill Clinton's speech?
Did he kill Reva intentionally?
I'm sorry?
Did he kill Reva intentionally?
I'm not prepared to give you an answer on that. No, wait. I'll tell you why I'm not prepared to give you an answer on that. Because firstly, when you watch the court case, there's no camera on him all the time, so you can't watch how he responds to things.
Yeah.
All you're doing is reading other people's interpretation of that. Mm. So what you need to do is you need to be able to watch him all the time, see how he responds, see does he have a negative gesture, does he squeeze his hands, or does he make a fist at certain times, and when he doesn't realize the camera is on him. These sort of little subtle things you can't pick up.
Can you switch that off in your mind? Can you meet somebody and just
it's
meet
very,
someone?
Very, oh, can I
yeah,
do that? So can I meet somebody just to meet them?
Yeah, without
absolutely.
Going into their
you
head.
You can?
100%. I don't go to some. I teach students, for example. I teach statistics and maths to varsity students. I go around to schools and I teach study skills techniques. If I had to sit there analyzing every single person while I'm teaching, I would go crazy.
What's the difference between that and hypnotizing people?
Okay, hypnosis is a whole different topic on its own. I don't know if I'm necessarily qualified to talk about hypnotizing people.
Yeah, like if you say I'm a mentalist, they expect that you can do that as well.
I say to people that I don't do hypnosis. Hypnosis is a speciality act. I can't make you do something that you don't want to do. In fact, every hypnotist, professional hypnotist, will tell you that they can't make you go out and rob a bank. For example, a walker run in the street naked if you want to. That's not in your value system because your conscious mind will not accept that thought.
If I had to ask you to think of a word, the chances are you might just think that I'm trying to influence you guys. So can I try something with the two of you? I have here a magazine. It has a number of articles, pictures, advertisements. I want you to take the magazine and I want you to open the magazine to any page, preferably a page that has lots of words on it.
But do us a favor. Sorry for it coming in.
Sure.
Here. Because we're sitting on either side of you, hold it towards yourself.
So towards
only
yourself.
You can, or you two can see.
You can only see it.
We wouldn't want you to say that.
It doesn't have to be the first page. We can
any
choose.
Any page that's got lots of words in it. You decide. It's your choice, entirely your choice. Now this is about, yes, now that's perfect. I know why. All right. Now I want you guys to choose a word between the two of you, one word, but make it an interesting word, a nice big word, a word with lots of letters, lots of syllables. So between the two of
and
you, choose a word.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, any word, a nice big word with lots of letters and lots of syllables. Mm-hmm. Do you have one in mind?
Yeah.
Yes.
Close the magazine. Okay. Now, He was just talking about this hypnosis thing. You can give me the magazine. And there's no ways I can implant words in your mind.
No.
Because you've randomly selected one.
Yeah.
Let's see.
That's scary.
What's the first letter of the word?
P.
P. P for Papa.
P for Papa.
I'm on the right track.
I swear if it gets this, then I'm like,
I'm done.
So for the first time, what is the word that's on your mind?
Should we say it together?
1, 2, 3. Possibilities.
No way.
No, come on.
That's not possible. Really? That's what I got.
There is no way.
But you know, right to the other extreme, there is a book published, 12 Have Died. And that is one particular trick, we call it the bullet catch. They put a marked bullet in a rifle, and the magician stands on the other side of the stage, and he's holding a plate here, and the gun is fired at his mouth, and he catches it in his teeth and spits it out onto the plate, and you can examine it. It is the same marked bullet that left. 12 have died through that kind of thing.
Is it not understanding the trick? Is it, where does something like that, where does a trick, I mean, we always joke about the sawing woman in half, right. And how and where do things go wrong? Is it not understanding the trick properly, perhaps doing it too hastily? What happens?
A mechanical problem cropped up in most of them. But I used to do, you mentioned sawing woman in half. When I was younger, I used to saw woman in half, but she left me, couldn't make both ends meet.
That type of thing you're talking about is probably more with the grand illusions. Mm. Where things could go horribly wrong. Doing a few card effects, whatever, it's not going to kill me, you know?
Yeah.
Nothing could go wrong unless somebody throws a card.
May I interject here?
You have.
Yeah. There's an illusion that has surfaced in the last 7-8 years, and I'm sure you guys know it. The premise is you have 3 pieces of wood, and on one of the pieces of wood, there's a spike. And the magician or mentalist has these in front of the audience, and he puts a cup on each one.
Polystyrene
cup. So that you can only see the cup covering the base,
yeah.
And you can't see which one has the spike.
Yeah.
And the premise is the magician blindfolds himself or is turned away, and audience members mix these up. And he comes back and he looks and he goes, he puts his hand over each one and he, have you seen that?
No.
And there's been internationally, there's been so many mishaps,
yeah.
Where the magicians have not studied it well enough, or something was wrong in their technique or their timing, or maybe the audience, they weren't able to build that rapport and comfort with the spectator, that they've actually pierced their whole hand.
Yeah.
They've sometimes taken an audience member's hand.
Oh no.
And
that is criminal.
Yes.
That's a lawsuit waiting to happen.
Yes. I think that happened, eh?
Happened a few times.
Yes.
But with these grand illusions, now I'm thinking of the likes of David Blaine. Mm. This man has encapsulated himself in ice, suspended himself, buried himself alive. I mean, that is a significant feat, and serious things could go wrong. Mm. Is that the next level? I'm just thinking of the most famous international magicians right now, and it is the likes of Dynamo, Chris Angel, David Blaine. They've moved away from the feel-good comedic. I think David Copperfield started it, but this is this dark sense of anticipation and I might die.
And shock.
But is that entertaining?
I think it depends. I'm a horror movie fan, for example. Oh. So I am one of those. So I veer towards the interesting and macabre.
David Blaine, in his autobiography, he says his reason for doing these stunts is because he feels most alive when he's dying.
It's about the show and it's about the business. And you're not going to make money if you're just going to sit at home and practice, you know? So you need to look at the business side of it as well. You need to be able to market yourself. I think Mo is probably one of the top guys at the moment that knows how to market himself. I studied a bit of marketing when I did my degree in business, and I'm actually clueless, you know, when it comes to marketing. But it becomes very important. And I think it's with any, not just magicians, I think it's with musicians as well. Any art form, you need to be able to market yourself.
My hero was a man, Billy McComb. He qualified as a doctor, and he got his papers at his graduation and went straight over to his parents and said, "Mom and Dad, this is for you." He hasn't practiced, he's dead now, but he hasn't practiced medicine one day in his life. He went straight into professional magic. And he said, I attended a lecture of his, he's an Irish in the UK. He said, there are three rules if you want to make a success in magic. The rules are all important, but the order is more important. Rule one is you must be a good businessman. And that applies to music and a number of things. Second, you must be a good entertainer. And third, you must be a good magician. You scramble the orders around and you're not going to make it.
Often people would say to me, what's the difference between you and David Copperfield? Well, Copperfield is a stage illusionist. I'm just a close-up magician. Copperfield does magic with big props. I do magic with little props. Copperfield makes big money. And I do magic with little props. That's the difference. That's the scale of things.
It's also, I mean, what budget you have and how big your team is. If you've got a team of 100 people, you can perform miracles. I mean, you can perform miracles with a team of one person one-on-one sitting at a table. For many people, that's more impressive to show you what we've been showing you here at the table rather than to watch a big stage illusion, because you know that you're involved in the process and it's happening right in front of your eyes.
And the thing about magic is you need to be likable. You need to like people before you can do magic. It's because you need to connect with people.
You should project a persona that the people in the audience think, I'd like to get to meet that person off stage.
I want to talk about Uri Geller specifically, and there is a controversy around him because he attributed his power to a higher power. How do you deal with that?
He specifically said it's not God, but it was from another planet. Interestingly, his manager came through South Africa, and a few of us, the Sunday night group, invited his ex-manager around, and we chatted to him. We weren't aggressive. He was a believer, which I think...
In Uri Geller?
In Uri Geller, yes.
Okay.
He said, look, what he does is for real. Now, a pickpocket can pick the pocket of a judge, but he can't pick the pocket of another pickpocket, if you understand what I mean.
Because he knows what to look for.
So, in other words, you've got to set a crook to catch a crook. And this is why we magicians are quite good with that. He said, all right, I must confess, Geller and his girlfriend and I and my girlfriend were in Paris. We were eating at a restaurant, the four of us. And as we walked out in the evening afterwards, suddenly a spoon materialized out of the air and dropped. And he goes, oh no, it's happening again. Anyway, the two couples parted and the manager said, my girlfriend said to me, oh, don't be an idiot. I was a little bit behind the three of you and I saw Geller throwing the spoon over his head. So we summed up to him. He said, in other words, the things that you've tumbled are just tricks. Most of us think that what he did by claiming to do the same tricks we all do, like spoon bending.
Two stainless steel teaspoons. I'd like you to each have a look at one, make sure it's solid, and I'll stand for this. I'd like you to point to one, either one will do. Okay, you're in unison. Great. That's the one. That's the control, right? Now, see, all I do is I'll rub on the base. The handle will bend upwards. Please, no Viagra jokes. With the lightest of touches, watch the base. Starts to bend. Can you see it going from there, Mauro?
Yes.
Yes?
Beautiful. Absolutely.
Yeah? These two are stunned in silence. Let's just see. A little more. Yeah.
And you're not attributing that to being from another planet?
Nope, no. I'm from this planet. Don't worry. I'm from the same planet you're from, right? Actually, let's do it again, right? Watch this. Watch
no.
It
no.
Actually, it's Mo.
No. I know.
Yeah, yeah. Have a look. Make sure it's solid. Examine that.
Mr. Auditor?
Yeah. Some people present that as being more than what it is. Actually, you know what? Since you enjoyed that so much, one last time, just for you. Watch this.
No.
There is no way.
There we go.
Wow.
And that is the big finish.
Wow.
Thank you very much.
Can I ask, are either of you ladies married?
I am.
Could I ask you, we haven't arranged anything beforehand, have we? Could I ask you to think back to your wedding day?
Yes.
Okay. But I'd like you to think of your individual ages, you and your husband, to think of your individual ages on your wedding day.
Okay.
Okay. Now, add them together. I don't want to know the separate dates, but I want to know the combined total.
Okay.
All right. Can you give me that total? I'm not a mentalist, so I wouldn't know.
It's 55.
55.
Yeah.
You split that 55 into two different values. Mm-hmm. I'm going to split it into four different numbers. For example, 35, 1, 12, and 7. 7 and 12 is 19, 20, 20 and 35 is 55. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking primary school stuff. But there is a second line, and I'm going to put four different values, 11, 8, 34, and 2. Yeah. 34 and 2 is 36, 38, or 55. Okay, close. Now I know what you're thinking. You're thinking my parents were cousins, but they weren't. Because interestingly, if we add these four together, 1 and 35 is 36. 36 and 8 is 44. And 11 is 55. If we add the four in the middle, 1 and 8 is 9. 9 and 12 is 21. And 34 is 55. If we add these four together, 12 and 7 is 19. 20, 21. 21 and 34 is 55.
It's like Super Sudoku.
What's this third line for? And that's for four different numbers. 5, 10, 3 and 37. 37 and 3 is 40. 50, 55. Interestingly, if we add the four at these 3 by 3, 12 and 5 is 15, 15 and 5 is 20, 20 and 35 is 55. Mm-hmm. If we add these four together, 37 and 7 is 44, 45 and 10 is 55. If we add the twos at the sides, 20, 37 and 2 is 39, 50 and 5 is 55. If we add the four in the middle, 8 and 10 is 18, 21, 21 and 34 is 55.
Makes my head hurt.
Now, I must tell you, when the principle behind this was explained to Albert Einstein, he gave up. He went back to his relatives. Now, I know you're wondering, what is the last line for? That's for four different numbers. 4, 36, 6 and 9. 6 and 9 is 15, 15 and 4 is 19, and 36 is 55. And interestingly, the columns, 35 and 11 is 46, and 9 is 55. 1 and 8 is 9, 9 and 10, 19, 19, 36 is 55. 12 and 34 is 46, 47, 48, 49, and 6 is 55. 7 and 2 is 9, 9 and 9 is 18, 18 and 37 is 55. So may I suggest that you got married at an ideal age? Now, I know what you're thinking.
Can you type 18 into the calculator? Don't let me see. So if you could hold it up so that I can't see. Just type 18 in.
Yeah.
Okay, I want you to multiply it by any three-digit number that you like. So just choose a random three-digit number and multiply it.
Okay.
Press equals. Okay, you now have a number on your screen that I could not possibly know.
Yeah.
Correct? I want you to take that answer that you now have and multiply it by a two-digit number, any two-digit number that you like. Press equals. Mm-hmm. This is making your head hurt. No? So far, so good?
So far, so good.
All right, good. You now have a 5, 6, 7, or 8-digit number on your screen. How many digits do you have on your screen?
I have 6.
You have 6. I want you to pick one of those 6 digits. Don't pick a 0, it makes my life too easy. So just pick any one of those 6 digits.
Yeah.
Keep it in your mind and don't tell me what that number is. What I want you to do is I want you to call out the other 5 digits. So you're going to call out 5 digits to me, but to make this tricky, you can go in any order you like. You can go forwards or backwards or jump around.
Yeah.
Just give me those 5 digits now, nice and slowly.
6,
mm-hmm.
0, mm-hmm. 0,
mm-hmm.
3,
yeah.
and 2.
And there's one number that you didn't call out.
Yeah.
Would you like me to try and tell you what that number is? Because there's some reason that you would have looked at that number and thought that's an interesting number. Or would you like me to make that number magically appear on your screen 6 times?
Meh, the letter.
Clear the screen. Okay, I'm going to have to do some mathematical calculation. I just want you to think of that number for me, please. Just think of the number that you're thinking of, your single digit number. Interesting, the eyes move to the left. That tells me quite a bit. Type in 407. Just type in 407. Okay. Multiply by 39. Press equals. That should give you 15,873. Correct?
Correct.
Perfect. Okay, now I want you to multiply that by 49. Press equals. What appears on your screen?
777777.
What's the number you're thinking of?
There you go. Insert applause here.
That was weird.
Thank you.
I take that as a compliment. That was
weird. Oh, I do, absolutely.
Wow.
We're all connected, and seven's a number that a lot of people would subconsciously choose, because if you say to somebody, think of a number between 1 and 10, they would normally go for 7.
Right, so these are American dollars.
Yes.
Eisenhower dollars, check them out. Coins you don't see too often.
No.
They're out of circulation, which means they don't use those coins anymore.
You get a buck in.
Except for me. Yeah. You probably won't get much.
Also so,
Alright, so do me a favor, Natasha, hold out your right hand for me. Right, now the coins are going to transfer from my hand and they're going to land in your hand. You'll feel the coins arrive. Right, so I've got 4 coins. Okay. All it takes is a little squeeze, a little shake. And that's coin number 1. No sleeves, okay? The second coin travels and lands with the first, Natasha. So I'm left with how many coins here, folks?
Three
coins. All it takes is a little squeeze, a little shake.
It's there again.
And that's coin number 2. So Natasha, how's your bank account doing?
These dollars.
Because I'm transferring all the money into my account. Oh, you didn't know that. All right, so Natasha, a little squeeze. And that's another one across. But Natasha, let's see. I've got 4. How many do you have?
I have 3.
No, at this moment.
Oh, nothing.
Shame. It's a bad month for you.
It is a bad month for me.
I tell you what, Natasha. I'll keep 1 coin. You keep the 3 coins. Hold it nice and tight. Turn your hand over. Keep your hand nice and steady. You got 3. I've got 1. Open your hand.
No.
That's brilliant.
Awesome. Thank you.
I love it.
Wow, yay!
Well, you with your magical memory, can you count cards? Because, I mean, that is a skill. I mean, so many people have been caught out at casinos because it takes some memory training and power training.
And
would you be able to do that?
Yes, and
cards?
Casinos...
Educate us. What do you mean?
Know which cards are in the pack and know which cards have been played and know which cards haven't been played.
Ben Affleck has been banned from casinos to do that. Yeah.
Really? In fact, a radio station phoned me a few weeks ago to have a whole discussion about card counting. I do in my shows a technique where I actually memorize an entire shuffle pack of cards. And what I do is I have a mnemonic or a code word for each card. It involves a whole memory system and it's quite complicated to talk about. But just to give you an example, the Ace of Clubs. When I see the Ace of Clubs, I don't see a club on a card. I picture cat, because C stands for club and T is the phonetic alphabet code for the number 1, because T has 1 downstroke. So when I see that Ace of Clubs, I picture cat. When I see a 2 of Clubs, I picture a can, because an N looks like a 2 on its side, and the C tells me club. So I have a picture, a mnemonic picture for every single card in a pack. So for example, if I'm just playing cards for fun, I would know which cards have been played, or if I want to keep track
even
of a certain suit.
Even you don't play cards with him.
So that's how we do it. But there are many trick methods of doing it, or there are ways you don't focus on every single card. For example, bridge players. I teach bridge players to keep control of certain cards. And what you do is you focus on the key suits. So you only focus on those cards in the suit. You don't focus on every single card. Or when you're playing poker, for example, or blackjack, you focus on the cards that are the tens, jacks, queens, kings, because those are the significant ones. And you just need to know when those cards have been played. But now casinos have all sorts of other tricks. They combine 6 packs of cards, and they have you cutting out of the shoe, and all these things to try and nullify to some extent. But you have got slightly better odds than the lay public, although not significant to be dangerous to the casino.
When I speak for the both of us, and I think we are utterly impressed.
Absolutely.
Utterly impressed. And thank you for making the time to sit and have lunch with us. Thank you.